Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning and happy Easter to everyone. It's lovely to see everybody out for this Easter service at Grace United Church and those who are watching on video at home. We're going to start with the land acknowledgement, and your part is the bold letters. Grace United Church takes seriously the commitments made to First Nations communities through the National Truth and Reconciliation Commission report, especially through the calls to action to churches like us. Therefore, we acknowledge this day that we gather for worship on the traditional territories of the original nations of this land, and we acknowledge with respect their history, their spirituality, and their culture. I would like to wish happy birthday to everyone who is celebrating this week, and also specifically happy birthday to Jim and Diane, happy anniversary to Jim and Diane Wallbridge, and happy 55th anniversary to Paul and Carolyn Scott, who are both members of our choir back here. I would also very sorry to announce the passing of John Reed Gardner, who passed away on March 25th at the age of 89. Our sympathies to his wife, Sally. There will be no service for John. Today, we will be collecting the donations from the Count Your Blessings calendar. These donations will be given to the Gananoque Refugee Settlement Group. I would like to very sincerely thank the Brass Quintet, who we've been enjoying. They are adding a great deal to our celebration this morning. The trumpet players are Gillian McDonald, Todd Wright. The French horn is Kathy Resdell, Redsel. Trombone is Kim Gudlowski, and tuba is Mark Moyes. The performance of our musical guest is kindly provided by the generosity of our member, Michel Denis. If you would like to support special events in our music program, please speak to our music director, Paul Harding. Reverend Takouhi is going to be taking a much-deserved break next week. Liz Church will lead the service on April 7th, and Barb DeGeet will lead it on April 14th. And I'd like to mention that we've got an upcoming event. There will be tickets sold here next week, but you can also get them at the Visitor Center or at Beggar's Banquet Books for The Bobby Show, which is by Michael K. Myers with Tim Holman and others. It's going to be held Thursday, April 25th at 7:30 p.m. Tickets cost $20, and they're available at the church office as well as the other places that I've mentioned. So next week, if you're here, you can get your tickets. I think I have hit on all of the points that were to be mentioned, so welcome to the church, and please enjoy the service.
Beloved. Good morning. Oh, come on. You can do better than that. Good morning, beloved.
Good morning.
The Lord is risen.
He is risen.
Hallelujah. House of the Lord, it's so good to get your beautiful energy of love and support. And I am not sure who's the culprit. But somebody brought me a helper today. I have an Easter bunny helper today. So whoever you are, thank you. I appreciate it. Because God knows I needed something to squeeze. Thank you. Beloved, it is so awesome to have you here with making our celebration to the maximum as humanly as possible in this day and age. So thank you for always blessing us. And Mr. Paul Harding, I have no words except gratitude to all that you do and plan for all of us. Beloved, today our spiritual focus reminds us that holy darkness is necessary as it gives way to an altered, abundant life. How do you get seeds to grow? You need to plant them in a dark place. Therefore, holy darkness is necessary as it gives way to an altered, abundant life. Today, once again, we light the Christ candle in our midst so that we are reminded the smallest light dissipates darkness. We don't need big shindig of a light. We don't need projectors. Christ's light, a little piece of love that we express, makes this world a better place. And that is our job. It's not just the minister's job. That is all of our job, to put others before ourselves. Our call to worship is responsive. The bold parts are your sections. So let us do our call to worship responsively. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
God's love leads our way even in darkness.
This love never dies. God's promises never fail. We give you praise, O Lord.
Give praise to the Lord. God's loving kindness endures forever. Let us praise the risen Lord and proclaim our hallelujahs. I invite you to stand as able and let us sing together our song of praise, Voices United 155, Jesus Christ is risen today. I don't know about you, but the Spirit is present. The Spirit who gives us power and strength to carry on even in the darkest moments of our lives is present, beloved. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered, I am there. He also added and said, let the little children come to me. So those of you who hear the voices of these little children, do not fret, but be happy because they are here. Beloved, our invitation to confession comes to us from Psalm 118. God has opened to us the gates of righteousness that we may enter through them. Confident in God's love, let us pray together our prayer of confession, and we pray as one family. Holy One, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we have been raised from the waters of baptism to share in your glorious resurrection. Yet often we do not live as Easter people. Our circumstances make us unsure of your promises, confused about your will, and afraid in the face of danger. Like Mary, we weep at the tomb and do not recognize your presence. We pray that you call us by name once again, that we may recognize you with confidence. Whenever we are tempted to fear death, give us courage to confess your Easter victory. Whenever we are distracted by petty conflicts, keep our minds on your reconciling love. Whenever we are overwhelmed by the power of evil, reveal again to us your triumph over the destructive powers of oppression. Forgive our shortfalls, we pray, and let our lives be a testimony to the abundant life you offer freely to all. We pray through the power of love. Amen. Our assurance of pardon is responsive. Beloved church, listen. God, who raised Jesus from the dead, has not given us over to death. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Beloved, our next song is very special because the words are written by our late Reverend Robert Belbin. Marilyn Belbin is here with us, and I am so humbled whenever I listen to her stories of Reverend Belbin, and I am honored to be part of this community of faith because of you, Marilyn, and because of your beloved late husband. And today, as we sing this new resurrection words by him, may we all experience a healing presence to us, upon us, and upon all our family members. May healing abound and love multiply. So let us follow the leadership of our choir and sing together a new resurrection.
Thank you.
you sound so good. You all sound so good. Let us prepare our hearts to hear the word of God this morning as we pray together prayer of illumination, and we pray as one family. Living God, by your Holy Spirit, open our eyes to see the new light of this day. Open our lips to tell of the empty tomb. Open our hearts to believe the good news. We pray through the one who is resurrection and life, the Word made flesh. Amen. We hear scripture.
Good morning. Let us listen to the living word of God. Today I will be reading Mark chapter 16, verses 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they could anoint Jesus. And very early, the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been risen. He is not here. Look, there is the place that they laid him. Go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of them to Galilee, and there you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and they fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. May God's word continue to be the living word for our lives.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Beloved, join me in your hearts for a short word of prayer. Holy One, today we celebrate love. We celebrate the fact that love conquers even death. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain, not just because we needed his blood, but because we needed to be reminded to what point we need to love one another. Bless the words that are about to be shared at this moment. Therefore, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts and minds not only be acceptable for your kingdom, but be transformative for us in this world. We pray in the name of the one who is resurrection and life, Jesus the Christ, our friend, our teacher, our example, that we need to follow. Amen. Dearly beloved, we have arrived to the most life-anticipating Sunday of the year of the church. We have arrived to the Sunday of the year, which is the reason why Christians gather every Sunday morning. Sundays are considered the first day of the week. Sundays is considered in the Christian faith the day that we celebrate Easter. We gather as Easter people. That is what Sunday morning celebration is all about. Did you know that Easter celebrations and gatherings were in place long before any Christmas holiday celebrations were formed? It's a fun fact. If we pay close attention to Easter, we would be filled with fear, but also with amazement, like it did the women who were going to the tomb, like it did the disciples. The resurrection stories, and I say stories because we have four gospels and we have four different stories, because there are four different witnesses of the resurrection. The resurrection stories take our breath away, but yet give us a new breath to an altered life to the better. Beloved, we have journeyed through the Lenten season where we focused on how the Spirit of God alters life. And if you were not in our church gatherings for the last 6 weeks, please go and check our YouTube channel and listen to them, so that you can hear what the Spirit has been telling us for the last 6 weeks. We went through Lent where we focused on how the Spirit of God alters life, starting at the edge of belonging, through disruption of life, through God's creativity. And moreover, our lives are altered even besides our enemies. Remember Psalm 23? You anoint my head with oil in the presence of my enemies. Last week, we heard how God alters the victory of this world. The world thinks that what Jesus did sitting on a donkey and entering Jerusalem from the east gate was nothing but humility. But then in God's kingdom, that is considered more powerful than the kingdom of the world. Today, we hear the resurrection story through the witness of the Gospel of Mark. Mark's Easter sermon is very short, just like the entire Gospel. Mark's Gospel is the shortest Gospel of all four. Seriously, you can sit down and read through the whole thing in less than a couple of hours. It almost seems like a telegraph, Maybe we can call it a text in the 21st century. So, but Gospel of Mark's witness really says this: Christ is risen, and they said nothing to anybody because they were afraid. In Mark's Gospel, there is no encounter with the resurrected Jesus. Instead, there is a mysterious messenger who issues a promise and a command, an empty tomb, and a group of women who flee in terror, too frightened to speak. I would be scared as well. I would be frightened as well if I went to the tomb and the stone was rolled and the body was not there. Beloved, each of the other Gospels shares at least two pieces of evidence as proof that Jesus has risen from the dead. Witnesses to the empty tomb and appearances of the risen Christ to multiple followers is a fact in the other three Gospels. In Mark, the tomb is empty apart from the messenger, but nobody gets to see Jesus or touch the nail holes in his hands. Unlike Matthew, there is no great commission to the disciples. Unlike Luke, there is no recounting of the Hebrew scriptures or a meal shared with travelers to Emmaus. Unlike John, there is no intimate conversation with Mary in the garden, nor sudden arrival of the risen Christ behind locked doors. It appears Mark's good news requires no resurrection proof based on encounters between Jesus and his disciples. I remember when I used to sell Tupperware, my distributor always said, "Takouhi, truth doesn't need justification." I guess Mark knew that at that time as well, so he had nothing to prove to people. However, and there's always a however with God, the Gospel of Mark has something more than proof. The Gospel of Mark speaks of an unshakable promise. Beloved, there is something more powerful in the promises of God than proof. There is something more in a wedding ceremony when two individuals covenant to each other with love and respect than having a prenuptial agreement. There's something more about promises to lift each other up, not to seek your own, but to give more than you can. The promise in the Gospel of Mark is, "He is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Beloved, did you hear that? He is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Where are you afraid to go in your life? What difficulties are paralyzing you? What can't you let go and let God? Will the disciples trust those promises? Will we, as the body of Christ, will we trust those promises? How many large stones do you want it rolled out of your life? God has already rolled them out. Trust and obey. Give more than you expect. The power of God's love has rolled all the stones away, beloved. Do not be afraid. How many disappointments are on your way? How many people have tried to control you, oppress
you, treat you like you are nobody. How many pain and suffering are holding you back? God says, you are my beloved. Follow the way of Jesus and go where Jesus has already gone before you. I've said this before and I say it again. My late mother always said to me when I came home angry from youth group or church, oh mom, this person did this to me. She would say, did they put you on the cross? Look around you. Is there someone that really gets under your skin, even in church? Look around you. Have they put you on the cross yet? We need to trust the God of love. We need to go ahead and live a life that Jesus lived. And I want to conclude this morning with this thought. Jesus said many words on the cross. At the very end, he said, it is finished. As if he looked at the eyes of his oppressors and his killers, those who mistreated him, and with the words of it is finished, he actually said, you have no power over me anymore. My body is finished. You have tortured me enough for me to have this fragile human body. My body is tired, exhausted, and dying. But my spirit is living and reliving and reliving and reliving and reliving and altering life to abundant life in this world. Beloved, when Jesus said it is finished, he reminded us that humanity doesn't have power over us. And moreover, again, God is not finished with this world. God is not finished with you and me. Because no human power can control us. Some people in church even believe that they can control each other, but you can't. No human power can control us because we are not puppets. God created each and every one of us with God's image. Catherine, the baby that's growing in you is created in God's image. She is a gift to this world. Hold on to each other. Hold on to each other as God created each of us in God's image. Respect. Go through grace no matter what. I always say, these church members here have it always reminded, whenever you say, I am part of Grace United Church, I hope that reminds you to live through grace. With every breath you take, treat everyone by the grace of God. Beloved, the Spirit of God alters our lives to the better abundantly. But we need to trust and go where Jesus is calling us to go. Do not get stuck in the tomb. The tomb is empty. The tomb is empty. The women went to do their rituals to take care of Jesus' decomposing body. But he wasn't there because he is alive. Beloved, in the Gospel of Mark, not only the tomb is empty, but Jesus is not there. How can this be possibly good news? In Mark, the resurrected Jesus is not described as being with you. Instead, he is going ahead of you. Where you think you're going somewhere you've never been before, Jesus is already there. Jesus is already there. In the emergency room, in the operating room, in the chemotherapy room, Jesus is already there. Dear Grace United Church, what more evidence do we need from the risen Christ? The 1,000-plus-year-old good news is still alive and kicking in our lives. Do not get stuck in the tomb, but go where he is going ahead of you. Christ is risen, and this is only the beginning of the good news of Jesus, not the end. It is in holy darkness an altered and abundant life is born. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us remain seated and sing together. Let us bread break together as we prepare our hearts for communion. Beloved, our communion liturgy is responsive as well, so the bold parts are yours. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit, source of life, the living word, and bond of love. We praise you for Jesus Christ, who reminds us that even in fear-filled days, cloaked with the powers of death, your eternal love arises and never leaves us. We rejoice
with all your people and with the angels, because love is stronger than death. In this meal, we remember Jesus, his promises, and the price he paid for who he was, what he said, and what he did for our benefit. On the night before Jesus died, he took a loaf of bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for all people. Do this in remembrance of me." In sharing this meal, we live out the mystery of our faith. Bless this bread and this cup, O God, the wheat and the grape, the farmer and the harvest, the seed and the sower. These simple elements are shared in community so that we may taste and see your goodness and become the united and the uniting body of Christ. For it is through Christ, in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, that all glory is yours, God most holy, now and forever. And now at this time, we proclaim the glory of your name with the saints of the past and the present and the future. And we come to you as our mother, and we say the words, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Beloved, the body of Christ, the essence of Christ, the gifts of God for the people of God. Beloved, we are going to share these elements with you. I would invite you to go to the center of the aisle and come forward. We will have two stations ready where you can pick up your piece of bread and your cup and enjoy it with thanksgiving to God, and then go to your seating spots from the sides. And if there's anyone who is unable to come forward, please just raise your hands and we will come to you. This table is sitting here at Grace United Church, 120 Pine Street in Gananoque. But this table belongs to God. This is the banquet of the Almighty. All are welcome.
Beloved, as one family, we pray our post-communion prayer, which is responsive. O Christ, we thank you for this feast of life, fed by your love and strengthened by your life. We humbly accept your call to go into this world, to live with hope, and to share your joy. You commission us. Beloved, our next hymn is to prepare us to open wide our hearts and our pockets and be reminded that what we give for God does not compare to what God has given to us. Let us sing together, Voices United 164. Obstacle to generosity. Fear that there isn't enough to go around, that if we give away, what will we have? We won't be able to take care of our own needs. Fear is like a big stone standing between us and the experience of the resurrection miracle. So who will roll away the stone? We will, through the gifts we now give. Our offerings are collected at this time as we enjoy beautiful music.
Thank you.
Beloved, I invite you to stand as able and let us sing together, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." And dedication that is printed, and we pray as one family. God of new life, we offer these gifts and those given through PAR and online, acknowledging our fear but stretching beyond it to generosity. Thank you for your empowering love. Amen. Beloved, our last hymn, the hymn of going forth, is "Thine is the Glory," Voices United 173. Sing it like you mean it. Word.
Look for the blessings that await you this week, everywhere you are found. You might find an empty tomb, but that is the good news. Do not fret. Be amazed by the power of love that lives far more than our imagination. Tell the story of hope. Weep with those who weep. Rejoice with those who celebrate. Life is a balancing act. And now, may the truth of the empty tomb keep you fearless and courageous. And may the power of God's endless love be evident to you today and always. Go in peace as people of resurrection and life. Amen.